Previously on End of Year.
I've summoned you here tonight for you to go behind enemy lines.
What division am I infiltrating, sir?
Micron a division.
We started off Pastor Plummer, started off the first winches, defining scripturally, the thought of anchoring practically.
This one's mine.
All right, ladies. I hope you've had your raw eggs and your Red Bull. You chicken leg looking wannabes are going to be put to the test.
Understand, what do you think you're doing here? You don't have a single chance of making it.
Never wish that you came. 10 seconds. 1 second off. You better step it up. As a mic runner, sometimes there's what's called a rogue scripture, and Pastor Elliot will call upon you to read it confidently and without hesitation. Jaden.
And Pharaoh called Joseph's name Sapphanethphanea?
You're out.
What? How dare you?
This has been our most important mission. So please, tell me and the team how we can obtain spoon.
You can't.
Listen up, Lieutenant. You better square yourself away and tell me how I can get spoon. I'm gonna kill you. What year is it?
It's 2024. Weirdo.
As a
white
runner, sometimes there's what's called a rogue scripture.
What? Give me that bandana. New year, new me.
Look, we need more manpower. The church has grown so quickly, we can't keep up with the demand for chairs on Sunday morning.
It's insane. By 10:35, I'm sweating like crazy. I need a whole shower. What am I, a vegan in a butcher shop?
My back is crippled. The physio's telling me twice a week that I'm 80 years old. Mick Liston's just getting sick and tired of praying for me.
205. My heart rate is 205. What am I training for? A Navy SEAL? Writing a book? Getting famous?
I don't want to write a book and get famous.
If it's manpower what you need, I know where you can get it. But I don't think so you'll like it.
Please tell us. We're desperate.
The security team.
What the heck? No.
That's it. They have numbers, but no speed.
Please, Jafar. Don't make us work with the security team. They took our best man. They almost took you out as well.
Shut up your face. Big shirt. Call Major Tom. Tonight.
Why are you sweating, bro?
I don't know, man. Just relax.
Yes?
Major Thorne.
We need to talk. We've heard you've been struggling since losing your main man.
Don't you dare bring that up. I'm still in trauma. You don't know what I saw. No one believes me. They think I'm crazy, but the speed, the speed!
We believe you. We're all struggling. We don't have enough manpower to support the growth of the church. Can't believe I'm about to say this. Mm. We need help from the security team.
What are you doing, bro? Bro, put that on me, put that on me.
Ha! Us, help you.
Now, why would we do that?
Major, each chair is 11.9 kilos.
We put out an extra 120 chairs each service. That's 1.4 tons in 15 minutes. You practically get to work out while at church.
You what now?
You practically get to work out while at church.
Oh man.
My name is Pastor Elliot, and my highlights for the year of 2023 have been many, and there's been countless things that I'm thankful for. I believe God has wonderfully helped our church this last year. It says in 1 Corinthians 16 verse 9 in the Weymouth Version, "For a wide door stands open before me, which demands great efforts, and we have many opponents." Many times opportunity and opposition are two sides of the one coin. We are living in a troubled world today, in which some have hardened their heart and are seeking to oppose God and the work of God. However, I also believe there's incredible opportunities for the gospel, opportunities for impact, and opportunities for greater service, perhaps greater than ever before. During this last year, as a church, we're able to host a number of powerful revivals. Pastor Chris Hart, Jesse Clark, Paul Stevens, and each of them added a dimension of faith and breakthrough to our church. We are also able to have a number of guest speakers come for a weekend. Pastor Jesse Morales from Prescott, Pastor Tony Huang. Both these weekends drew large crowds, many visitors, and many saved.
Our 180 scene in Morley began with Christian as the outreach director, and from April through to September, we picked up a real momentum. Hip hop nights were a huge success, as well as other specials like Christmas in July, Pan African Night, and Battle of the Burbs. One highlight was the Listen Before I Go suicide prevention drama. Many people were involved and played their parts. There was a Holy Ghost conviction moment at the end, with people telling their testimonies about how Jesus set them free from suicidal thoughts. It was a very powerful time. We saw 36 decisions across two nights. At the beginning of the year, Midday Outreach was struggling with low numbers of people coming. So we began to stir and encourage people to be involved. And by the end, we were seeing 20 to 30 plus people coming out for Midday. Also, what helped this momentum was some very successful impact teams to Bali, to Kalgoorlie, Geraldton, and Adelaide. People were returning with amazing reports of being used by God, which then caused others to want to go on the next impact team. And then upon returning home, they were stirred to keep on being used by God in evangelism. As a result of all of that, we have a new wave of young people excited about evangelism, excited about the things of God, to the point where they were lining up to give their testimonies at the 180. 2023 has been a year of incredible fruit in the 180, in Midday Outreach, and on impact teams abroad.
Before birth, the doctors declared me dead, and this shaped the next 25 years of my life. Hi, my name is Misha. I grew up in a Christian home. At birth, I was declared dead, but God did a miracle in my mum's life. This kind of shaped my childhood. At the age of 12, my parents got divorced. This kind of shook my foundations. And when my parents separated, it kind of threw the entire family dynamics. So by the time I was 17, I completely left church. And by the time I was 18, I was pregnant in a toxic and volatile relationship for the next 17 years. It led me to addictions, it led me to alcohol, you know, drugs. Basically a way to escape the emptiness. One night I'd been drinking and my partner had woken me up at about 3 a.m. Telling me to come outside. Mind you, I'm still drunk, and I follow him, and there's a noose hanging on the patio. My first My first thought was that it was for me. And I believe if my cousin wasn't there, it would have been. I tried talking him down. I tried telling him to come inside. I eventually went inside, went back to sleep, and he woke me up with his phone spotlight in my face, and he smashes his phone into my nose and tells me that I want him dead, that I don't care if he dies, that I'm trying to kill him. I went back to my bed and I cried. I could do nothing. I called out to God and I said, I need you. I'm trapped. I have no way out. I need you. I know you're real. I need you to fix this. So it was Easter weekend, 2022. My mum invited me to a church production. I don't usually go to them. I remember crying at the scene where Jesus is crucified. You know, that a perfect being would die for my sins. It tore me open. And I remember, I gave my life to Jesus that night. And since then, he's done a miracle in my life. He's, you know, restored my family. He's restored my kids. There's a hope. He's delivered me from addictions. God has blessed my life so much. There's been ups and downs, but overall, he's worked a miracle.
Look, boys, the way that we do things around here is very different. But I have a secret weapon that I think will help the both of us.
We know. Speed.
What? Where did you get that intel from? That is top secret information.
You know, we can literally hear you down the road screaming speed all night.
Well, it's embarrassing now, isn't it?
Tell us more about this, speed.
Look, I've been pulling intel on this one for a year now, and I can't get my head around it. It's been driving me insane. There was one man that could hack it. Chris Rollenfeld.
How did he hack it?
He sped off before I could ask. I wanted it for my own selfish ambitions, but he seen right through it. For all I know, he could be in Queensland by now.
Looking for me?
What the heck?
I hear the church is growing at a rate that can't be sustained the way things are going. Is this correct?
Yeah.
Don't tell him anything! He's just gonna steal it!
I believe this is a good reason to reveal what I've learned about speed. It's simple, really.
Tell us!
Now, before I explain, Major Thorne, is that my pen? Are you ready? It's unlocked when you become available. This message will self-destruct in 5 seconds.
Well, that was freaky.
A highlight as our church is our National Bible Conference in March, with our main speakers of Pastor Greg Mitchell, Pastor Payne. The theme this last year was taking the gospel into all the nations. There were record numbers in attendance, and on the Friday night, the stage was filled 2 rows deep with couples going out into the harvest field. This year, we've sent out 3 couples in our March conference. And to be honest, I didn't think there would be any more until next year. However, in September this year, we made more announcements, with Pastor Glenn and Jess Plummer taking over the Darwin Church, and Christian and Sonia taking over the church in Queensland. But there was still more to come. As we recently announced in November, Andrew and Jessica Sutton taking over the Clarkson Church. Yeah. It's been a year of giving out, but God is faithful to his word. He has supernaturally been bringing back with record numbers again and again in our services. Our recent Sunday Christmas Eve services were packed to the back. The church saw many saved over this weekend.
All right, maggots, team meeting. Listen up, we got a new mission. We are going to be working with the ushers to help with the mass gross population of the church. You will all be assigned an usher and they will show you the ropes. All right, maggots, let's get to it. Move out.
Okay, now I'm going to teach you how to smile. Just follow my lead. Can you do this? More teeth. I want to see some teeth. Yes, more teeth. Keep coming. More teeth. Yes, yeah. Now take those glasses off. Oh, forget it.
Hi, my name's Terry. What's your name? You speak English?
No.
Now, this is what we call a chair.
Weapon.
No, that's... It's just a chair. Something you sit on.
Oh, yep. Ejection seat, F-22 yeah. Raptor.
No, just a chair. Just a chair. It's just a chair.
Iron Maiden.
It's something you sit on, all right? Watch this. Chair.
Whatever.
Whatever? What do you mean, whatever? It's a chair.
Whatever! So Major, this is just a chair, right? And you just sit down. That's it.
Nah, mate, you're not making any sense to me.
Hey, Major, have you ever sat down before?
I've stood to attention my whole life.
He's joking, right? He's joking? Are you joking?
Come on, Major, have a seat. This is a chair. Sit down. Come on, sit down. Sit down!
Hey Major, this is great and all, but I still haven't seen the secret weapon.
What did Chris say? Something about being available.
What the?
Who turned the light off?
Who turned off the lights?
I don't know, Terry.
It was a rhetorical question. Hey, I didn't think you spoke English.
I can't see anything.
Yo, Sean, why are you sweating?
I don't know, man. Relax.
You.
Yes, it's me. And I'm here to get my revenge. And take everything from you boys.
Now, fam, let me get this fool. Security team. This is how it's done. Prepare to meet your maker, my boy. Let me know how it goes.
Speed.
Yes, that's right, Major. Speed. You see, I was there listening to Chris. So I did what I had to do. I cleared my calendar. I quit my job. I deleted Disney Plus. And I blocked YouTube. So yeah, I guess you can say I'm available.
Quick, someone become available.
I'm available. I'm available to kick your butt.
Who else wants to become available?
I've just signed up to an impact team! Yeah!
Is that guys have got.
Guys, quick, huddle!
I know we gotta be available and stuff, but remember, we need to work as a team. I've just messaged Pastor and told him I'm available for a park outreach. Who's with me?
I can't do that letterbox.
I can do the sausages.
All right.
I could do that sitting thing again.
I can bring the toilet.
I will bring the visitors.
All right, who's with me?
Yeah!
1, 3! 1, 2, 3!
You guys are doing
gotta be available. Gotta trust in him and you will see the favor, bro. I ain't compromising even if they pay me more. God first in my heart, placed him on the throne. Yeah, gave him all my burdens, couldn't take a load. Yeah, gave him all my hurt and now my pain is gone. Don't you know my God is good? I gotta pray the Lord. Yeah, my brother and my sister have a nurse.
Someone keep his head still.
People on their way to a burning seat.
Wait. Hey, man. Whoa! Calm down!
Anniversary of this church was the 22nd of October, 2023. The question I asked, what should we do? I believed it was an important milestone that needed to be recognized and celebrated. I called Pastor Greg and said, I know it's last minute, but can you come and be our guest speaker during that weekend? He immediately says, yes, I'll clear the calendar. We also invited a number of direct plants out of the Beechboro Church back that weekend. We organized a 180 tribute concert with Pastor Greg and Lisa rejoining the original 180 band. Sunday church, we had a lunch on the front lawn and had a very special week of revival.
I received a telephone call from a police officer from Armidale Police Station the other day. I was surprised to get a phone call from a police officer, and he was equally surprised that I picked up the phone. You see, that police officer was the person who began to perform CPR on me on the 7th of April, 2023. I'd suffered a complete cardiac arrest. I'd crashed off my bike at 45 kilometres an hour. And as a result, I suffered a brain bleed. Doctors were unsure whether I was even going to wake up.
Okay, so Craig had gone for a ride in the morning, and around, I went for a ride myself, and I just walked in the door and I got a phone call. And it was from the police officer from the Armidale Police Station, the phone call that you never want to get. And he had said that Craig had had an accident. He was riding his bike. And I thought, oh yeah, he's, you know, fallen off his bike. And I didn't really understand how serious it was until he said to me, it was very fortunate there were some people close by who were able to perform CPR. I went, what? You mean his heart stopped beating? And he said, yeah, he's with the police officers, the ambulance officers right now, and they'll be taking him to Fiona Stanley Hospital. So the first thing I did was I called my sons and I told them everything that I knew. But my second next phone call was to Megan Matthews, to tell her. And I said, you need to pray. I don't know what's going on, but it's not good. We got to the hospital and were ushered into a family room. The doctors came in and they told us that Craig had suffered a cardiac arrest. His heart had stopped beating while he was riding, which caused him to crash on the bike. And that wasn't all. After he crashed, he hit his head quite badly, and they found that he also had a bleed on the brain. Numerous cuts and grazes. He'd broken his collarbone, his sternum, ribs. He said to us that ordinarily under these circumstances, they would just go in straight away and sort the heart out. But the problem that they had was, in order to do that, they needed to thin the blood. And with a bleed on the brain, that was a problem. So they just wanted to wait at this stage. And so they admitted him to ICU and put him into an induced coma.
It's all in our hands, this life of time.
I've since learnt that the doctors were in a bit of a dilemma. If they were to fix my heart, they would have had to have thinned my blood, and that would have increased the real issues of the brain bleed. As it was, the brain began to swell. I got a temperature that was associated with that, and they had to wait 3 days before they would start to consider looking at my heart and doing something with it. The Sunday after that Friday, I needed another 3 shocks in hospitals to set down and sort out my arrhythmia issues. But Monday they went in and said, we've got to fix it. So they put a stent into my heart.
Pastor Elliot and Pastor Hagenson actually came into ICU and prayed for Craig. Resurrection Sunday, that just as Pastor Elliot, I remember him praying, just as Jesus rose again, God, we pray the same for Craig.
When they got in there to take a look at that, they found that that artery had opened by itself. Now, we believe that wasn't just by itself, that God had a hand in that. And that was a real miracle.
And a CT scan afterwards of his brain showed that the bleed, even though they thinned his blood, the bleed hadn't increased in any way. With that procedure going well, it meant that now the heart issue was dealt with. Now it was just, we needed to focus on the cognitive. So over the next few days, the doctors would come in regularly just to see his progress. And they would ask him things like, Craig, can you hear me? Open your eyes. And initially he couldn't, just like he wouldn't wake up even. So the prayer requests went out. Megan, Bob, please get the people to pray.
I know I made progress, but the progress was very slow. I began to be able to speak. I could move my hands a little bit, but not enough to be able to feed myself. But one day when my wife did come in, she asked me, what's my name? And I couldn't bring it to my mind. But I called her beautiful, and that was enough.
And so I remember the physios came in because they had measured him for a wheelchair. And based on what they could see at that time, which was a Friday, they said to me, I think we're going to need to order a tilt wheelchair, which is one that he can control, put your head back. And I needed to be prepared for the possibility that he wouldn't be able to go back to his job again and that he may well need full-time care. My next phone call was to the Matthews, and I said, Megan, this is what they have said to me. I refuse to accept it. We knew our God. We knew that he wouldn't have done all that he had done to this point to then leave us in that situation. There was an Indonesian nurse actually who was looking after him that day, and he started speaking to her in Indonesian. And she didn't know his history or didn't know what he'd been through, so they're having conversations in Indonesian. And I walk in there and I thought, yesterday you could hardly speak English and now you're speaking Indonesian. And it was just amazing to see the difference. The Monday, the next day, the same physiotherapist came back again, and I said to them, so how's it going now? And they said, you know what? Cancel the tilt wheelchair. Cancel any wheelchair. He's not even gonna need a wheelchair.
I was discharged from hospital about 5 weeks after Good Friday. And God continued to do amazing things in my life. I had to go to an outpatient cardiologist appointment. And when I walked in there, the cardiologist looked at me and said, well, you're not doing too bad for a dead guy. That took me by surprise. He wrote a letter to my GP, and it's interesting. I'll read a little bit to you. It's unusual. He said, I caught up with Craig today and I've taken a bit of an instant liking to him. Of course, my first line to him was, you look pretty good for a dead guy. In all seriousness, this bloke had a serious, inopportune time to block his proximal ostial LAD. He was cycling at 40 kilometers an hour, so obviously he crashed his bike, hit his head, and had a hemorrhage that caused a few problems. He goes on to say, the proof's in the pudding. On the 20th of April, 2023, his echocardiogram was completely normal. Craig is traveling along rather nicely. The doctors have cleared me now to be able to cycle and exercise to my heart's content. And there's been a real amazing miracle delivered into my life. I want to thank my children for supporting me, and I want to thank my beautiful wife for being there every day for 5 weeks, taking care of me. God is good.
The ladies in the church who provided food, I didn't need to cook for 5 weeks. Just the friendship of everyone who was supporting me, and most importantly, just the prayers. And I know everyone was praying for Craig, but I know that they were also praying for me, and I felt their prayers. So I want to thank everybody who helped us both through this time, and of course give God all the glory for where we are now.
Yeah, we want to thank God, and we want to thank the people of God for their support. I receive texts and phone calls from lots and lots of people overseas, pastors, people in church, they are praying for us. Even to this day, I still receive messages asking how I am, and I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful I'm still here, and I have a second chance.
As we bring this year to a close, what is vision for the new year? No doubt, as I look back over the last year, I see God has tremendously helped us. We've seen many, many converts, record attendance, numbers of couples sent into the harvest field. Looking back with a heart of appreciation on this great night, I stand with amazement at the faithfulness and goodness of God. And now as we begin the new year, we ask the question again, what does 2024 look like to us in our church? I believe as we pass a milestone of another year and get increasingly close to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, I feel like never before, it's not a time to slacken off. It's not a time to slow down. It's not a time to take our ease and get distracted. But as the Church of Jesus Christ, we should pick up our pace. We should refocus our vision on Christ and the finish line. We should renew our heart's passion for God, this church, and for the great harvest field in front of us. I ask you as the pastor of this church that you would join with me, that we'd look forward to 2024 in faith, and that perhaps this coming year can be our greatest yet. Because as the writer Clovis Chappell writes, in Christ, always the best is yet to come. The scripture in John 2:10 speaks about this. You have saved the best till now. Finally, in conclusion, my wife Gillian and I would like to thank this church. It's been a great honor and privilege of being your pastor this last 2.5 years. It's been an honor to take over from Pastor Payne and Janice and the great work they have done. And I'm believing God to help us to continue on these great foundations. I appreciate every person, every member, all of our pastors, every leader, every disciple, every worker, and every new convert to this church. I'd like to say again, thank you. May God bless you now, and may God bless you in the new year. Amen.